Jean-François LeJeune. I'm professor of the University of Miami School of Architecture and been involved in various projects of research and publications, one of which is this new book that is being worked on, which is a unique collaboration between a series of writers and researchers that are located in San Francisco with Daniel Solomon, at the University of Miami with myself and my colleague Verushka Vascones, and at the University of La Sapienza in Rome that includes Lucio Barbera, who is an architect and a former dean at the School of Architecture, and Anna Irene del Monaco, who's a professor and researcher as well. This book is somewhat in a certain way a casual encounter of having had the chance to spent a couple of days and then weeks and weekends and so on in Rome with Daniel, because we have the University of Miami has a program. We rent a small ground floor building in Rome, and Dan came to give lectures. We walked through the city, and we in fact walked outside of the city, or outside of where 99% of the people visiting Rome or as tourists would eventually be, i.e. we're working outside of the great Noli Plain, the great areas of Rome that are the combination of development from Etruscan to Roman, medieval, Renaissance, Baroque. So this is the Rome that most of the tourists visit, and which at this time contains about 5% of the population, 50,000, 60,000 people, where there used to be 200,000. And where do people live outside of Rome? They live in fact around, on the outside of the walls of the city, where eventually the city expanded to accommodate new residents coming originally to support the administration of the capital, Rome, capital of Italy after 1870, and then later on rows of working class people to support the beginning of some industries, essentially in service industries and gas and electricity, and eventually continue on to the Mussolini period, more administration, more workers, and culminating after the Second World War in the area of 1945, Rome was about 600,000-700,000 people, and now it is in the 2 millions. And all of that was accommodated in a somewhat continuous manner, which is one of the theme of the book. So the cover, the book will be called something like The Splendid Ordinary, which is essentially the sort of ordinary fabric, Roman neighborhoods 1873, 1963, those dates and those words can change, but you can see a series of figure grounds that illustrate where the focus of the book will be. And because we were just discussing this issue of social housing just a moment ago, the book contains a quite deep focus on the concept of social housing from the 1890s all the way to the 1960s, and how in most of that period social housing was eventually integrated relatively well and relatively in continuous fashion with the middle class city, let's say, or with the rest of the city. The book will sort of depart from an interesting constatation, which is that the Roman building type, this little townhouse or row house, whatever you want to call it, which is about 5 meters wide, 5.5 meters wide overall, by about 10, 11 meters deep, essentially cells, sort of two cells unit. That unit of housing that was eventually established in the Middle Ages, around 1100, 1200, over the memory of the Roman insulae and the Roman domus, that building type that has an enormous capacity of adaptation. You can see just here, for example, the position of the staircase, the way the windows are, and so on. That little building type, in fact, has been continuously applied all the way to the 1960s in the city of Rome, within various form and various morphologies, of course. The other building type that we all know is the palazzo, which we will talk in a moment. And this building type, the sort of little townhouse, is still what you can see in some of the most famous or the most concentrated area of the city, for example, the area of Campo dei Fiori, Palazzo Farnese. And even though those houses have grown up by floors and floors over time, you can still see this unit of five, six 6 meters wide houses with their window pushed to the side in order to leave maximum flexibility in the arrangements of internal partitions. And eventually that type, that depth of two cells you can see here, is eventually how the Roman developers or the Roman promoters or the Roman aristocracy or property owners eventually adapted the sort of row house type by combining them and developing eventually the sort of apartment living which makes up most of the city. And you can see it in this slide, the two-cell system, which is very much like the townhouses assembled, the 2.5 cells, which were eventually an evolution that allowed to create a service rooms like bathrooms and things, but also interior corridors, for instance, the 3 cells, which developed more for somewhat more bourgeois apartments with a large hallway at the center on both sides of the staircase, and eventually the 4 cells, which eventually creates courtyards in the center marked by the axis that provide light into the bathroom, into the kitchen, and so on. So that is in a way a sort of an introduction to the concept of typological continuities, which exist in many cities, but which is particularly profound and particularly complex and present in the case of Rome. And so leading from the townhouse to the palazzo to what is called the casa in linea, which is the apartment building, which eventually, as you can see on the right, could form its own palace of sort if you have in the real morphology to support it. And so the book will go through a series of examples of the master plans that were developed in order to expand the city. You see here in 1909 in gray the consolidated medieval Renaissance Baroque city, and in red the sort of new neighborhoods post 1890, and in green, an interesting approach which was not always developed, but of developing a sort of a garden city-like master planning to take over or invade in some way hilly terrain, a different type of hilly terrain which is quite present around Rome and which has nothing to do with the Seven Hills. It's the hills that are the sort of second ring of hills along which Rome is being built. And I'll just go very quickly, just going to the slide, different neighborhood in terms of the continuous city experiments in the continuous city, social housing experiments from 1883 to 1930. You can see some of those circles indicating the position. You see that at the beginning they are very close to the center city, to the walls, and eventually develop further according to land purchase, garden cities ideas, and so on. But what we realize in developing this study is the rich, at the same time, a high level of tradition, for example, the grid city, which is not particularly present in Rome, contrary to other places such as Florence and Torino, for instance, but the incredible variety, the typological variety that the architects of Testaccio, for example, the first real working class neighborhood built in Rome, according to 2 grids slightly disjointed, as you can see, with a big square in the center, you can see that the blocks being, although almost the same scale and the same size, in fact, developed over 10, 15 years, an incredible variety of typologies, essentially with the meaning of trying to create interior public space or interior semi-public space, i.e. courtyards that can really be used and that are not only light well, and also the capacity of those plants to provide for light and hygienic, the sort of hygienic movement, finding as much as possible light inside the apartments while maintaining the sort of continuity of the streets that surround every block. And you can see here an example, for instance, of one of the most famous blocks by Pirani, which really display a quite elegant and important garden in the center, with this idea that was developed in those years that people would enter the block through big portals, and eventually you would ascend your apartment through doors that are facing the courtyard, thus creating a certain level of privacy for the social housing, but also allowing, for instance, what Jane Jacobs would say, you know, the capacity from the kitchens and the rooms inside to survey the kids, to see what's going on, to have an eye on the courtyard and an eye on the street, in a way. It's kind of expanding, in a certain way, what Jane Jacobs was saying. Triomphale, which is a quite extraordinary project in north of the Vatican, which starts to the right as a sort of a middle class structure, quite interesting, quite powerful itself, but ends to the left, in the very end left of the slides, into a social housing neighborhood, which in terms of typology is very very different in the way that the blocks allow you to penetrate, contrary to the bourgeois block, which was essentially sealed on itself. But all the blocks that you see, for example, on these slides are done by one single architect. And thus, this issue of how do you, as one architect, build an entire block and provide for an urban landscape that actually is not systematically repeated and provide for variety and diversity, bringing in the case of Rome ideas from the countryside as well, because most of the people who will eventually come to Rome will come from the countryside, either the Lazio countryside or Sicilian countryside or southern Italy countryside, and eventually transforming from a rural people into urban people. Piazza Mazzini, another very important neighborhood that you can see here, also with very wide, very quite exceptionally designed urban blocks. And the one that we've emphasized on those slides are in fact those that are reserved for social housing. But they're somewhere in that slide. You can't really see it fundamentally. They are almost continuous in terms of architecture and in terms of their uses. The difference is the penetration, the sort of permeability of the building. Quite interesting, quite complex architecture that is not very Roman in itself. Rome building don't have loggias and terraces and so on, except at the palazzo level. But this is types of buildings you would see in the countryside, in the hill town, for example. The book will also look at a couple of interesting, relatively exceptional examples in Rome, maybe in a sort of a futurist way. For instance, here in Monteverde, Via Donna Olimpia, which is a complex, you can see it all in yellow, complex of high-density apartment structures that are at the same time futurist, a bit of New York, and are in this particular case are very famous as in terms of social history for various reasons, including the fact that Pasolini actually lived in one of those buildings and wrote Ragazzi di Vita, which is his first major novel. Other large concept, for example, the sort of super block idea as it developed throughout the late 1920s, early 1930s, still maintaining the capacity of coalescing the residents around public space inside and sidewalks that functions in the traditional manner. Some neighborhoods here, for instance, are more like Garden City-like, but they're still using apartments. There's something special in Rome is that garden cities, in fact, are multi-family. They are not based on the concept of single family, even though there are some exceptions or some exceptional blocks, but they're usually small-scale, 2-3-story apartment structure. This San Saba is beautiful. You can see the details of the brickwork, of course, which you can see also here in Stockholm. La Garbatella, a larger type of garden city from 1921 to 1935, built on a very complex topographical situation with two hills combining into each other, and a neighborhood that show evolutions of stylistic ideas from, let's say, a sort of romantic nationalism in the 1920s to somewhat more nationalist, imperialist, led by Mussolini. But these are images both of the outside of La Garbatella and the inside of the blocks, which shows an extreme density of ideas, of details, and beautiful integration with landscape, which is not always a Roman quality, I must say. These are other views. Something that we discover in the making of the book that for us is very, very important is what happened after 1931 in the development of the city, partially driven by the master plan of 31 by Marcello Piacentini, which has the idea of the palazzina. The palazzina, as what you can see on this map, are all those little dots. And if you look at them, you realize that they create streets. You can see the streets that are in between the dots, but the dots are actually single apartment buildings, and their characteristic, as you can see here, particularly in the lower side of the slide in Piazza Bologna, neighborhood of the 20s, 30s, the characteristic is that they're basically single apartment blocks with four facades. They create streets, they have some interior spaces, but they are, in effect, a discontinuous type. And Rome is an exceptional case in the history of urbanism where the developers essentially found a way of using lots that were originally planned for villas and transform them into lots for apartment structures. And they have problems. There are problems in that type of urbanism, but it certainly is the type that is the most frequent. There are about 600,000 people living in that type of apartment built after 1935. So it's a huge mass of the residential structure of Rome, with still a quite not as beautiful as other important streets, but still streets that function as streets, that have a clear definition of what public versus private, and thanks to walls and a series of objects that allow to connect various buildings to each other, as well as streets of different sizes and widths and so on, both from a more middle class or low middle class in Piazza Bologna to higher classes or high middle class, for example, in Parioli, where in that location, a modern architect actually were able to develop their structures without breaking the continuity of the space. Here you can see an example, and some of the most famous by Luigi Moretti, for instance, show that street, that slightly turning street in Rome, is made out of, in fact, absolutely discrete, simple, individualistic building in a way, breaking with the concept of the townhouse, but forming a capacity of public space. After the war, there will be other experiments. I have 3 minutes. So on Via Tiburtina, a very interesting example. You can see the difference here between the red roofs, which is 1945 to 1950, and the flat roof of the Palazzine, which are at the bottom. This is a village in the city, the concept of a village in the city, developed by Mario Ridolfi and Ludovico Quaroni, which was essentially really a social housing neighborhood for people coming from Sicily. So these were people who arrived from a very different environment, and the idea was to try to integrate them in part through a type of landscape, a type of typology that would suggest memories of where they came from, and certainly would try to avoid the full image of the traditional city. And these are neighborhoods that are still functioning quite well and that have high density. These are the original publication in Casabella, where you can see that done by modern architect Ridolfi, Quaroni, and definitely people who have vindicated their modern education and so on, are full of elements that borrow from Roman and Lazio vernacular, including the houses with their outside staircase that you see there at the bottom right. And eventually, where things start falling apart, perhaps the first example of the discontinuous city in Rome is, interestingly, the Villaggio Olimpico, the Olympic village built for the Olympiads of 1960. By a group of very important architects again, Moretti, Libera, and so on, to the north of Rome. And you can see that for the first time, this is really the first moment, so this is maybe the end or the beginning of the end of the book, or what happens in that case, where under the auspices of the Olympic concept, this became a village for the athletes, for the sport, and eventually sold as social housing to the residents. But it is the beginning of a very different idea, where instead of developing structures in continuity with the existing city, Rome will continue to develop with a series of individual social housing projects, which in itself or in themselves usually continue to provide interesting qualities, but are now discontinued from the fabric, difficult to reach in terms of public transportation, and thus have a tendency to become ghettos of different sort, depending on the conditions. The book will finish with an article on cinema and the cinema in Rome, which in fact uses those neighborhoods more than anything else in the city, from the neorealist to Federico Fellini and so on, showing that what we see in the great period of Italian cinema from the 40s to the early 70s is actually modeled on that other Rome. Rarely do you penetrate the historic center. Most of the time you're dealing with the transformation, the transforming suburbs, the developing periphery, and of course La Dolce Vita, 8.5 are perfect examples of that. So this was 16 minutes. Thank you very much.